have to tell you, I'm somebody who's addicted to research. And so when I walk into the reading room of the New York Historical Society, I immediately experience the kind of adrenaline rush that I assume hardcore gamblers feel when they walk into a Las Vegas casino and see the gleaming slot machines and the roulette wheels. What I love about coming here to do research is I get excited not only about what I know I will find here, but even more what I don't know I will find here.
I think a person who likes history, who feels that the past is important, comes to a place like this and their heart beats faster, their pulse gets quicker, because they're seeing things for the first time they didn't know they were here.
It's alive. It has a life to it. This, the city is alive in that place. That is the issue.
New Yorkers, rush, rush, rush. This is a city of enormous change. People come in, people go out with great regularity. You walk into the Historical Society and you get a sense of time slowing down to some extent, and a chance to contemplate, a chance to ponder, a chance to think about big questions in a calm way, to stop and look inside yourself as you look at the exhibit and say, what did this mean to me? I never really took time to think about this. And so in a sense, it gives all us busy people, not just in New York, but in the whole country, a chance to slow down and have a little moment of introspection.
I think that in New York in particular, since New York has a long history of having a very unsentimental attitude about its past, it's a place that kind of prides itself at times on the flux and the change, and we celebrate the present and we look eagerly towards the future. To have one place in the city that really preserves and honors the past is a special responsibility, I think also a special opportunity.
This is the greatest city in the world. And the greatest city in the world has a history, and that history has affected all of the history of the last 200 years. What happens here affects the world, and has for a very long time. Certainly what happens everywhere in the country has some relation to this city. And the New York Historical Society stands at the center of all of that and is the custodian for national treasures. And that's no small responsibility. It also, of course, puts this collection, this place on the map in a way that is incomparable. It doesn't matter whether you are from Pennsylvania, as I am, or if you're from Massachusetts or California or Texas. A part of your story, truly part of your story, is here, because this city has been the capital of the commercial and entrepreneurial and artistic and cultural lifeblood of the country for 200 years.
When I think about the fact that the founders of this great institution had the foresight 200 years ago to preserve their moment, and by definition, the subsequent moments in the development of American history as seen through the lens of New York. I think how prescient they were. The history of New York is indeed the history of America, and the history of America, to a great extent, particularly in the first half century of the United States, was inextricably intertwined with the history of New York.
It's almost uncanny the extent to which one can recreate the year of 1804 by spending time in the reading room here. I mean, it was, for me, such an extraordinary gift doing a biography of Hamilton to have the papers both of Hamilton's second in the duel, Nathaniel Pendleton, and Burr's second, William Van Ness, as well as so many other Hamilton and Burr-related materials. That I felt sometimes at night when the reading room was closed that their ghosts must emerge from the shadows, because it's a very poignant feeling that these people who knew each other in life there in the reading room and in the collections are, as it were, reunited in death.
1804 is an interesting year. It's the year that Alexander Hamilton is killed, and it's the year that the society is founded. It's the end, in many ways, of the Federalist era and the beginning
on the other hand, of this incredible institution. The men who founded it, I think, were what today, it's a word that's thrown around a lot, were patriots in the truest sense. That is, in the sense that they believed that this country was in a remarkable experiment. In 1804, no one really still knew if America was going to survive. Certainly no one knew we were going to emerge as the number one country in the world. So here you have a group of men who feel the revolutionary generation is passing. And so there's this sense that the story of America, and particularly of the revolutionary era and the Constitution and the founding of the country, will get lost, will fall through the cracks. And this group of men come together and say, someone has to do something to preserve these materials, to collect these materials in one place. Why not us? And so it's founded on a wing and a prayer, in a sense, by men who are not professional curators, not professional archivists, not professional museum directors, but men who really want to make sure that Americana has a place to rest. And so it's an incredible, ambitious, and wonderful idea.
I'm always impressed that there are people at every historical moment who recognize that history is being made in their own time, and that if they don't do something to capture it, to collect, to preserve it, then no one else will, and future generations will be impoverished as a result. So I'm very struck by the recognition when so many things were happening in 1804. It was a complicated, difficult city, and some of our founders led rather tumultuous lives, and yet they recognized the importance of their historical moment.
This society was founded by people who were trying to explain to this new country what it was, what it could be, what it ought to strive for. Generations later, we're still asking those questions. And the information contained in this building is critical for helping us to answer those questions. I mean, this is serious business. These institutions provide the society's collective memory. Without this, we operate from scratch each time, and we can't do that. This provides the kind of historical context that we need as citizens of a democracy to make an intelligent, democratic decision.
The society, I think, retains its amateur status for a very, very long time. The New York Historical Society keeps searching for, as its collection grows, keeps searching for another place, an adequate housing. And I think that that in some ways is so typically New York. Its Catholic notion of what it ought to collect is, in my mind, wonderful and also presents problems. They collect and they collect and they collect. They accept and they accept anything people are willing to give them, and then they face the problem of where to put it, how to take care of it. And so the society had to make this incredible leap, like the city, from one era to another era, and I think has done an amazing job.
It's done remarkably well, and I think we want to celebrate not only the fact that it managed to survive many moves in its first decades of growth, but that since 1904, 100 years really at this location on Central Park West, and when it moved up here, Central Park West was not the Badlands of South Dakota, but it was pretty far up. And I think it was very prescient on the part of the leaders to also be on the edge of Central Park and really secure for posterity a location which is just spectacular and quite remarkable.
It's a remarkable place. It has two or three elements going at the same time. You have the documents collections, and there you have to have enormously knowledgeable archivists and librarians. At the same time, there's remarkable art, and that entails a completely different set of demands for preservation, for exhibit, for display. Then there's the educational branch of the society that opens itself up to school groups and to people who want a program of study here. If I bring my undergraduate students and my graduate students here every year to introduce them to sort of the hidden treasures and the wonders that they can find here.
To my mind, a great archive should have original newspapers and periodicals, original manuscripts and documents, original books and pamphlets. Some historical societies are strong in one or the other. The New York Historical Society is really strong in all three of those dimensions.
From my point of view, from the point of view of a practicing historian, this is the place that has your tools. This is the place to which you come to find the substance that you work with. I mean, this is the raw clay that you build your final product out of.
Well, sometimes I'm sure administrators and trustees wonder what is the point of collecting all this stuff, because estimates are that it can cost you from $40 to $100 plus for every single object that you have every year forever. And so we really have to question, why are we doing this? Why go to this huge effort? And I think we really have to believe, and I think we do believe, that the memory that we have that's important is enhanced if we have documents and if we have three-dimensional objects. If we can go back to the original newspaper, and this institution has one of the finest collections of early American newspapers in existence, or if we can go to the bucket that DeWitt Clinton used to open the Erie Canal, which really opens the West to settlement, to look at the lottery wheel, which is one of those that started the worst civil disturbance in American history in July of 1863, to see a wooden water pipe, to think that that's how we got the water by hollowing out the insides of logs, to see the great chain that was used in the American Revolution to try to keep the men of war of the Royal Navy out of the Hudson River and to keep them from dividing the colonies against each other, to see the wonderful creations of Charles Comfort Tiffany, to see the toys that go back to the 19th century, the guns, the eyeglasses, the paintings, and I think on through the present to see pieces of the airplane on September 11, or the pieces of the safe deposit box, which was cooked at 3,000 degrees for 30 days or so, or to see really what looks like it's trivial, some dust from the World Trade Center. So we really don't know what's going to be valuable from one generation to the next, but we try to make the judgments because we realize it's a serious obligation and it's a costly obligation, and we take it very seriously.
This place is filled with people speaking for themselves in their own way, in their own time, in their own vocabulary, whether it's with paint or words or whatever. And we can hear them and we can talk to them in effect, or at least get a sense of what their world was. And I know that interest in the stories of what went before us is part of human nature. Every child's story used to begin, once upon a time, long, long ago. And if we ever lose that interest in the past and respect for the past, then I think we're losing something that is essential to our human nature.
It's a place that's, for me, it's a very important part of my life and creative life. When I was a young New Yorker, from the ages of 9 or 10 to 14 or 15, I'd visit the Historical Society a lot. And we had the greatest time there. The magic of the place. We didn't understand, of course, at the time, the holdings of the New York Historical Society. We didn't know that, but we knew it was something very magical and specific because of the city where we lived, that we came from. We were also introduced to a series of five paintings, painted by a man named Thomas Cole, and we became fascinated by those pictures, and the sense of Arcadia, the first one, and then building up to a smaller society, and then the giant center painting, I believe, was of its height, the ancient world, and then the war, and then finally the ruins. And that stayed with me all my life, those pictures. It was the first sense of the waxing and waning of a society, of a world, of time, passage of time. But I remember being so fascinated by myself and my friends. We'd go and we'd just stare at the little figures, the painting, especially in the largest one, I believe that was the height of the empire. And we'd stare at it. Everything was painted, and you could feel the brushstrokes and see the faces, and it was a quite extraordinary place.
There's nothing like seeing representations of great historical figures to make you realize how much they are like us, though they have different styles, how human they are, how revealing their eyes are through those portraits. You imagine, what would they be like? What would they feel like? What would they talk like? When all the players are assembled on the walls, and you could say, well, that's what that old turkey looked like, and that's what she looked like. That portrait gallery brings them more to life for me, more vividly than 10,000 words ever possibly could.
Ultimately, history is built piece by piece from our primary sources, including letters and diaries and old newspapers, broadsides, every kind of document. One thing historians learn very early in their careers is that it's quite unpredictable what you may find.
There were enormous number of research finds that I made here related to the Hamilton book. For one thing, people had known in general terms that Hamilton was an abolitionist. But I had wondered when I started the book, it was just this kind of decoration, something we say but that didn't have substance. You open the minutes here of the Manumission Society and you could see that Hamilton was much more than just decoration when he co-founded the first abolitionist society here. You go through the minutes and you see that he was an active presence. I also was able to find here a very significant find that Hamilton, in one essay, is taunting Jefferson as a slaveholder, is taunting Jefferson for believing that blacks were genetically inferior. It's taunting Jefferson's view that if we emancipate the slaves, we would then have to resettle them, because Jefferson said this would stain white blood. And Hamilton says, of course, Mr. Jefferson must know from direct experience of the staining of blood that can take place while the slaves are still in bondage.
You know, we have those documents inside this structure. These are some of the most treasured documents in all of our past, and they're here, and there are thousands of other things like this in which we can tell the American story.
Without places like this, America doesn't know itself, and it can't know itself. That's one of the reasons that the New York Historical Society and historical societies all over this nation ought to receive great thanks from the American people as a whole for what they provide.
People talk about behind-the-scenes tours, and I always think that institutions like this ought to force people to take behind-the-scenes tours so that then they can understand that it's not just a question of, is the picture hanging straight on the wall, or do I have a nice card catalog or a digital catalog to look through, that there's an enormous amount of work involved in preserving intact and authentically the records of the past. I think, to some extent, what people have learned about how difficult it's been to preserve the Declaration of Independence and the cost of keeping that ink on that page. I think maybe people are more aware of how much goes into it, but I think a required trip around the back halls of the society might be useful for everyone. People who come to work in places like this are not in it for the fame or the money. They're in it for some kind of sense that it's worth preserving the masterpieces and even the everyday life of the past. And so I think that there is a reluctance on the part of historians, antiquarians, genealogists, New York City supporters, patrons, scholars, a reluctance to ever see it fade. Lots of organizations like this come and go, and 200 years is some kind of test of people's sense that there's something here worth preserving.
It's possible that the New York Historical Society holdings could have been collected in, you know, Syracuse or Metuchen, New Jersey, or somewhere else. But the likelihood is it would be captured somewhere where you have both great size and great wealth and high density and kind of a whole kind of melting pot of things coming together, I think, in a very unusual way in New York City and in this institution. You know, has it been easy? Has it been smooth? Has it been always ever up? Of course not. You know, we've had our ups and downs. But through it all, we've managed to survive, as has, of course, the city has had its ups and downs, and even the nation has had a few ups and downs over the time.
We have many reasons to care about history. I think it's a source of strength. I think it's a guide to how to behave. And I think it's often a way to remind ourselves in the most vivid fashion imaginable that if we think we live in tough times or dangerous times or uncertain times, that there have been others often before us who faced equally difficult and dangerous times, if not more difficult and more dangerous. And if they can rise to the occasion and keep their faith in fundamental human values, we can too.
I think we see a reflection of that in my predecessor, in Ken Jackson's brilliance in recognizing when everyone, I'm sure himself included, saw tragedy on September 11th. He was able to recognize at that moment that it was tragedy, but it was also history. And that to me is really, really the essence of an institution like this. It can capture all of those moments and the brilliance of all of those people who recognized that it was important to collect the effects of their own historical moment for the good of future generations, and to collect it and to have a physical presence, a physical institution in which all that material could be kept and made available to people.
It does seem to me that 9/11 shocked people into some sense that things in America could be destroyed, and may have increased a sense of how important it is to cherish and value things that have been preserved. Many of the things in this society, after all, went through the Revolutionary War, went through the Civil War, went through the War of 1812, went through draft riots in New York City, went through all kinds of, went through economic depressions. That is, in a sense, the artifacts in this museum are survivors. And I think 9/11 increased our respect for survivors and our sense that we should nurture what has survived. Well, I want to start by saying that I think it's wonderful that the launch of the next 200 years begins with an exhibit on Alexander Hamilton, because who better represents someone who, in the midst of crisis, has a vision that things can be magnificent? I mean, my favorite story about Hamilton is that in 1780, when it was far from known that we would win the American Revolution, in fact, it looked really quite grim, when other people are wringing their hands, Hamilton sits down and writes out a blueprint for how America can emerge as one of the great nations of the world. And I have a sense that the New York Historical Society, coming off both 9/11 and the crises of terrorism in this country, coming off the crises of its own that it lived through, it's so appropriate that it looks forward and says, we have the stuff to be a primary institution in the life of this city and of this nation, and we're going to do it step by step, and here are our plans, and here's the beginning, and won't you join us in this?
I think its mission remains every bit as important as it was in 1804, which is to preserve the common memory of us all, because it's so vital as we move into the 21st century. I think history is important to everybody and every people and every nation. But here in the United States, where we do not have a common ethnicity or a common religion or really a common race, and some would say even a common culture, history is more important because it's all we have that holds us together.
Which I think brings me to the most positive recent development in the history of the New York Historical Society, which is its openness, its inclusiveness about the Black presence in New York and by extension in the United States. So many institutions like this were lily white. I mean, Black people played cameo roles if they played a role at all. So in the opening up of the American Museum to the experiences of the historically and heretofore excluded is quite gratifying, and it's something that I applaud in the agenda for the next several decades of the New York Historical Society.
I think this is a very, very good moment to think about history, who tells it, who gets to tell it, how is it told. My ambition for this institution is for this to be the center of all those debates and discussions around history. And I think that we can easily achieve that.
We want to be the place for history in New York. And everybody know that, and everybody consistently feel that they can come here and learn about history. But I think there's just been an extraordinary transformation at the New York Historical Society in the last 10 years. And I think we're going to see another extraordinary transformation in the next 10 years.
It's a great moment for all of us who want to see history brought back to life, re-energized, reinvigorated in the curriculum and in our museums. I don't think in my lifetime, at least, this sort of thing has happened before. It's a rebirth. And I say hallelujah, amen.
When I walk into a place like this, I feel I'm home. I feel I'm exactly where I want to be, doing exactly what I want to do with my life. I depend on places exactly like the New York Historical Society, and have for 40 years. And my gratitude, my appreciation, my awe for what these institutions represent grows greater with the years. And I want to see it continue for other people in the future, and for the country in the future. Patriotism can be expressed in all kinds of ways, and anyone who supports the New York Historical Society are doing something that is so directly in the service of the country, it would be hard to think of anything more useful or with longer lasting benefit.
Its importance for me, as I said, isn't calculable. And the reason is why should we care about a place that analyzes and chronicles how we live? Well, we should care about the past, about how we live, because if we don't care about ourselves, we don't care about our present society. We have to learn from the past, really, or at least to be aware of the past, to understand who we are and where we're going. To destroy that is madness.
I want to join with everyone else in wishing the New York Historical Society happy 200th birthday, and with the wish that it enjoys many more centuries of success and good work.
My wish for the Historical Society on its 200th birthday is that every single person who calls themselves a New Yorker walk through that door in this year.
First, birthday wish for the New York Historical Society, that it continues to have hundreds more.
Well, I would wish, very grand wish, that the wonderful toast that was given at the Society's founding in 1804 will be repeated not only this year on our birthday celebrations, but in another 200 years.
Happy 200th birthday, New York Historical Society.
Perfect.
Yay.